Calling the signals on our opening play from scrimmage of the SWAC MEAC top. He then hands it straight up the middle. And it looks like Jamaris Tompkins took it right off the left side and picked up good yardage. The Wildcats of Bethune Cookman. Hurry up offense. And another give. Same play. And Tompkins this time met right at the line of scrimmage. Didn't pick up much there.
Right away, you see Cookman coming out trying to run the football, but they're also trying to go high tempo, high pace, foot on the gas pedal, trying to wear down this Alcorn State defense early.
Third down. That grab is met hard. Blitzing off the side there was Michael Hearns. And Hearns then took it down to her.
And this one has to go to the quarterback. Hearns comes on a blitz from his linebacker position. You got to see him. You're living bread. You must know your protection. Wide open guy, free end of man on the line of scrimmage. That's on the quarterback all day. He's got to get rid of that football hot.
They did a lot of blitzing last year. They collected 44 sacks as a team, so they know how to get to the quarterback. And that one lost 4 yards, and we have an injury down on the field. And it's David Bryant, number 72. He's the starter. Warford is the long set back behind him. They do the pitch, and Warford has some room off the near side. And Warford fumbled the football. Who's got it? Two are fighting for it.
Whoever comes away with that should have it, because they both had the football at the bottom of the pile. Trenton Bridges, number 42, was there for Bethune-Cookman. And it seemed as if they both had it. I think you just let them have an old-fashioned tug-of-war. And you'll see Warford get popped, carrying the ball a little bit high, bodies flying around him. Now that seems like joint position, doesn't it? I say give it to whoever comes away with the football.
Well, Alcorn State must have come away with it because they kept it and give him a gain of about 5 or 6 on that play. So that'll set up a 2nd down and 4 to go. And dodge a bullet that time.
Jamori McKenzie, number 11, able to go in there and wrestle with Trent Bridges for that football. That's a wide receiver taken away from a linebacker. That can't happen, Eric.
All-star offense, 75. 5 yards, remain 2nd down.
So Edric Thigpen, a little false start action, so they give that little game back to him. So it'll be 2nd and 9 yards to go here. Ball at the 30-yard line. Lenore Footman out of the shotgun. And breaking tackle, just Warford gets to the edge. And Warford out across the 45-yard line. Good guy from Annette. He picked up 15, and we got a flag on the play after he was whistled down.
Yeah, clearly a late hit. Over on the sideline, some jaw took place.
I think that Quan Richardson came over in there, number 22. Free safety came in there a little bit late. And see how they sort it out.
After the play, personal foul, defense, number 22, 15 yards from the end of the run, automatic first down.
You see the talking, and you know, Warford, he's a vocal guy, stands over Richardson a little bit. Richardson didn't like it too much. Talley is always the second guy that gets caught.
Been one of the most penalized teams in their conference, the most penalized team in the MEAC last year. Penalties hurting there, a 30-yard gain when you had the run and the penalty. This one will pick up a couple yards.
Well, let's think about it. I saw a graphic there, said one of the most penalized teams in the conference, one of the most penalized teams in the country.
Right.
Last, but yet they were 9-2. So the question is, they're so good, they're able to overcome those penalties in spite of a lot of them being too early.
This is Delange Turner, 6'1", 214-pound junior off the left side. Picks up good yardage. He picks up 6 and gets out to the 32-yard line. Set up 3rd down and long two. Jeremy Davis was one of those in the secondary who brought him down.
3rd-2, easily attainable in the way the offensive line for all courts performed thus far. Seems like they have the ability to maybe do a little option grip.
Big pass out, screen over on the far side, plenty of room, and fumbled the ball again, and Bethune Cookman has recovered it, so a good pass play looked like it was going to
stop the run, swing pass to the outside to McKenzie. And at the end, good job of getting the helmet on the football as Elliott Miller, number 7, able to knock the ball loose. That's just a technical tap, but that's how you play cornerback. You shield the receiver trying to block you off, and you lunge.
Did not keep the football with him. Keep turnover. We're going to be in the green zone, some call it the red zone, inside the 20. So Bethune-Pittman takes over, first and 10 at the 19. And it looks like they might be changing the call at the line of scrimmage. Larry Grimm. He's your quarterback out of the shotgun. Low snaps, Grimm getting deep. Has good room. On the far side, Grimm getting close to first down yardage, up to about the 29-yard line before Darian Anderson brought him down. Anderson leading that team to tackles last year with 73.
One thing we have to see is how is Alcorn going to slow down the good Cookman's rushing attack? In the Celebration Bowl last year, they got shredded by Sweet Cohen. Cool Cookman looks to try to have the same type of success running the football versus defensive line from Alcorn.
Maris Tompkins is a long set back behind Larry Grant, second and short. And Tompkins is met right away. Coming in off the edge was Stacy Garner. Garner laid some lumber.
And Mitchell Error coming here. You see him coming from this side of your screen. That's got to be an easy one right there. Up-block, stand-up linebacker. Put somebody on him. Don't allow him to take hits on your running back like that. That's twice. You see the all-court defense blitzing linebackers made tackles for loss earlier this game.
A loss of one on that play, but he's still third and short, third and about a yard and a half. Grimm looking to throw, throws a quick pass, and boy, that gets brought down right away. He hits his tight end, Jaquan Loomis, but I think Loomis is going to be spotted enough for the first down.
Still, he'd like to pick third and one to a team that wants to control the line of scrimmage. I'd run the football a little bit more. They need to stop doing self-inflicted wounds and really go back to bearing down this all-corner defensive front.
This is two-pack Ismi. And Ismi right up the middle picks up 4. Before he's brought down by a host of white shirts, including Stacy Garner on the play.
But when we talked to Brian Jenkins and the coaching staff about running the football, they were so high on Michael Jones and Rayshon Nelson. Didn't mention Tompkins or Tupac.
No.
Who's got the carry so far? So the element of surprise is something that the Wildcats are known for, and they're still playing slot.
And some coaches keep their secrets, don't they? Good pickup on first down for Ismi. 4 yards on that play.
The Alcorn safety starting to come up from that support, only about 7-8 yards deep.
Grimm on the keeper. Grimm will get close to first down yard. He gets up about the 38-yard line, picked up 4. That'll leave a 3rd and 2. He was brought down by Darian Anderson.
That ability to rip off 4-yard runs fairly easily. Who makes this offense vulnerable.
And a quick snap, but I think it might have been a little bit too quick. I don't think they were set. We'll see how they... Grimm Jr. Quick slant pattern, and did he hold on to it? I guess he did. They'll call him the catch. He still will be a couple of yards short of the first down. Frank Brown, 13 preseason All-MEAC selection.
He's one of those 4 wide receivers that they feel good about. Ball's loose, and he looks up and says, oh, still have an opportunity to make the catch. Great concentration to make the catch.
Held on to that one. It looks like they're going to bring the punt team on. 4th and 2, a little bit too long. We'll have to go Terry Sims. And so coming on the punt will be Jonathan Cagle, who averaged 37.3 yards per kick in the 2015 season.
Early in the season, guys still a little bit deeper fired up. Never seen the opposing team just take the ball and run with it.
That's the thought they saw something that. Now, each score of the 2016 MEAC SWAC Challenge, no score. 5:59 to go in the first quarter. Later tonight on ABC, you can watch number 10 Notre Dame against Texas at 7:30 p.m. Eastern Time on ABC. Also available streaming live on Watch ESPN and the ESPN app.
It's been a crazy opening week of college football. Notre Dame, Texas, Charlie Strong really needs that victory. Brian Kelly having to deal with a little bit of turmoil there. South Bend, so it's going to be a good matchup there. Definitely feel that Texas needs that victory more than the Irish.
Keep your penny in your side. Have some room. And as pushed out of bounds at about the 47-yard line where they'll still be short. Jamal Brown's stuff going on. We're scoreless here, 3:08 to go in the first quarter, and both offenses a little sluggish, if I say so myself.
I have a feeling out there that we do all the conditioning. These are two really physical football teams, too, so anytime you've got teams that pride themselves in being physical, it takes a while for them to wear down the other team, and so far, no one is budging.
Two possessions so far for Bethune Cookman in this game. Two punts. Solid field position here. Ball at the 36-yard line with Larry Brim Jr. in the shotgun formation. Off the play fake. Looking deep. And he overshot his man. He was looking for Jamie Wilson down the middle of the field. He was well covered.
And then once again, trying to figure out the philosophy behind Bethune-Cookman's offensive attack. They like to run the ball. You've got four returning offensive linemen. Every time you run the ball, you're getting 4 yards a pop. So what do they do on first down? They pass downfield incomplete, put themselves behind the eight ball. And I like to think if you pass first down incomplete, you probably have to throw the ball on second and third down as well.
Two backs split to either side of Brim, and Brim on the keeper. Met right away, might have picked up a yard on the play. And he was met by Eric Foster.
Eric Foster is the next it guy for Alcorn State. Number 25 in white. Plays that little free safety slash strong safety position. Last year it was Warren Gatewood, who's now in the NFL. And Eric Foster, big time prospect, great size, 6'3", 200 pounds, 4'4 speed. He's a playmaker.
And they go empty. In the backfield, five receivers, three split to the near side, two to the top of the screen, far side. And Grimm throws near side, and that one was off the mark as he was trying to find Frank Brown. And that one, as soon as he let it go, you just knew it didn't have a chance. It led him way too far.
Yeah, a little bit of a nothing drop, because it all starts off with the first pass, first down incompletion, then second down, run stop, and nothing there. Disappointing drive for Bethune-Cookman. They had the ball in decent field position. Once again, I wouldn't relax. Come to football, Marquise Warford back there. Once he gets his hands on it, you know what he's capable of doing. This is a watch-out moment for the Wildcats.
Marquise Warford back standing at his 30-yard line. And it's Jonathan Cagle. He'll strike this from about his 25. That one's a high, deep spiral.
He's going to get this one.
Yep. And Warford met immediately, got it out across the 15 to the 16-yard line. 49-yard punt, a 2-yard return. Still scoreless in the first quarter. As plenty of guys serious about this MEAC scratch out. Toward the International Motor Speedway, we had the pep rally and pregame barbershop where guys got their fades and everything taken care of. And Warford, again, we talked to him Saturday morning, and by Saturday afternoon, he was bald. So he got all of his taken out, and he's in the backfield next to Lenore's Footman. He'll keep it on this side, and it's stacked up a little bit and buried by a host of maroon and gold. Over on the near side of the field, one of the first ones there, Trenton Bridges, and he lost 3 yards on that play.
And you can see now that the Wildcats are keying in on Warford, where he lines up on the field, whether he's in the backfield or in the slot. He's just a marked man right now. They're holding him up. He's in the secondary.
He's replaced by Delance Turner right now while he takes a breather on the sideline. Hopefully his game isn't too serious. Pass out to the far side is met for a loss of yard as Elliot Miller. And speaking of Warford, he took a big hit a little bit earlier. They worked on him on the sideline a little bit, so he might have reactivated that.
Yeah, we featured him, you know, right here. You want to finish off the run, but are you better off staying in the game? But that's a collision right there on the right shoulder. Then he goes to the sideline, and what are they working on right there? The right shoulder. Then you go into the ground and go shoulder first. Physical football game.
A little quick hitter, the wide receiver wound up losing some more yardage, so third and very long. Footman will was a quick one to the running back. He hits his back to Lance Turner there, and still a loss of even shit to Marquise Warford. Tiffany.
Well, Marquise Warford came to the sideline being tended to by the trainers, massaging his right thigh. Appeared to may have been a cramp. We saw him limping on the practice field yesterday during a walkthrough, but while he was on the training table, there were a couple of words exchanged between he and members of the crowd going back and forth, and Marquise says he has worked really hard to try to mature and not let the emotions get the best of him, and this is a good test for him right now to see how he bounces back.
All right, Tiffany, we've seen six total possessions in this game. Five of them have ended in punts, one a fumble. So I guess so far you can call it a defensive battle.
Two physical teams just going at it. A lot of pride and egos, and nobody's willing to budge.
Last punt, 17 yards. This one gets a favorable roll, and boy, dangerously close to the blocker down there as he finally got away from it enough to cover it.
To see them really establish that they're going to pound the football and run it on a continual basis.
Harry Grimm Jr. looks like he's changing the play, getting the signal from the sideline for Bethune Cookman. Now going deep. That one well overthrown as he was looking for Travaris Copeland on the far side and threw that one over his head by about 5 or 6 yards.
And one of the things that's intriguing, the last time we saw Alcorn State was in the Celebration Bowl playing a MEAC team. And North Carolina A&T ran the football on. They carved him up good. I thought for sure that was going to be the game plan for the Bethune Cookman. Show that Alcorn's improved on their run-stopping defense, but Bethune really haven't challenged them. They've run the ball a couple times, but they have not force-fed the running game, which I think is going to be the key for this offense.
Cameron Rigby, redshirt sophomore from Miramar, Florida, 5'7", 177, is the lone setback alongside Grimm now in the shotgun formation with two receivers split to either side. And Grimm, quick out, has his man on the near side. This time he found Jontavious Carter, the Miami transfer, picks up good yardage, and he's driven out of bounds by Diego Sama, playing his first big-time college game, a junior college transfer.
And highly recruited out of the state of Florida, Boca Raton, played cornerback in high school, then became a wide receiver. This is his first start as a cornerback, graduation, and some key losses for the defense.
8 yard pickup on that play, so call it 3rd and 3. Grimm on the pitch. Inside and falling, and let's see where they're spotted. That was Tupac Ismay. And he was brought down by Sama, and he'll be very close. I think they'll give him the first down.
This is a good job by Sama. You know, one thing, when you put them out there to play cornerback, you know they can cover a little bit, but how they're going to defend the run, running back came out to a minimum, textbook tackle in the open field, but Bethune Cookman still able to get just enough yards to pick up the first down. Take a good look right here. That's Eric Foster. So you locate Foster, you kind of tip the hand for a little bit, so he's getting close to the line of scrimmage, like he may want to blitz in the perimeter. He's a guy giving the ability to cover or rush the pass.
Grimm rolling out, gets his man, fumble the football. Will they call that a catch and fumble? I guess they will. So he hit his tight end that time, Laquan Loomis, and he picked up 5 before he lost it. Is this a catch though, Coach?
I don't know if the official saw the ball come out towards the end. They rolled the quarterback away from the blitz. What do we say? What's a catch nowadays?
Gotta make that football move up the field with possession.
But we never saw the beanbag come out like it was a fumble, so right. I said I don't know if they saw it.
Quick pass to the near side. He finds his man, Jontavious Carter. And Carter is brought down by Sama, and he picks up first down yardage once again, so they'll move the chains. This is the deepest penetration for the Wildcats so far in the game.
Just start to settle down and take the underneath routes, 5 yards, 5 yards. if you're Alcorn State, you have to be careful for the double move. Slant go, pitch go, over the top, catch a peek in the backfield.
Every Wildcat touch to a man said they're trying to wait for those next guys to step up and be leaders, and a game like this is a perfect measuring stick for them as Grimm on the quarterback keeper picks up three. Stacy Garner brought him down.
And that's key. I mean, Bethune, we talked about their dominance. They won 4 out of 5 Midwestern Athletic Conference titles, and they had that star power. They had Ryan Davis, and the defensive line was always something you could hang your hat on. Last year, they didn't have that. Teams averaged almost 25 points a game against them, which was something they were unaccustomed to. And they're still looking for who's going to be that go-to guy, offensively and defensively.
Second down, Grimm pump fake, goes down the far side, he has a man, touchdown! Jontavious Carter got behind the defense, the pump fake help, 28 yards on the play.
And that's taking advantage of a young cornerback. They kept going with the underneath stuff, and we said, be careful for the double move. They were setting you up for it. They got Diego Sama jumping on the first move. Good play selection. You see, give him a little pump, freeze him. That allowed Carter to get behind the defensive back. Sama, who was looking in the backfield for the touchdown.
7 plays, 54-yard drive, took 2 minutes and 1 second. And the extra point by Uriel Hernandez is good. So Bethune Cookman strikes first as they find Jontavious Carter, the transfer out of Miami, on the 28-yard touchdown to lead 7-0. And Bethune Cookman pretty happy about it on the bench. And that's exactly where he'll take it. Mitchell, you can hear.
Down here with Daytona Beach's native son and Vince Carter. And Vince, you said before we came on that it felt good to be back on the football field. You were on this field in high school, but as a drum major. What memories does it bring back for you?
A lot of memories. I mean, I love my city, Daytona. It brings the memories. I had a lot of fun being in the band. I love music, and just come here and support Bethune Cookman like I do year in and year out. This is usually my final ride before I go through the season. Come out here and watch them play their first game, and I usually go back for the season.
You'll be entering your 19th year in the NBA, the third year with the Memphis Grizzlies. What keeps bringing you back?
Love for the game. And nothing else. I just love to play, and it's not out of me yet. When I don't want to play, don't want to put the work in, that's when I step away from the game, but right now I still love it.
So no hints on when retirement may be coming?
Not right now. At least we know number 19 is definitely going to go down, and I'm shooting for 20, and we'll go from there after that.
All right, good luck to you this season. Thanks for your time.
Tiffany Green and Ben Sanity. Vince Carter, 19 years at a professional school. That's a...
I want to tip ass, can he still dunk? Rob McCann, still one of the greatest dunk champions of all time. Put him up there with Dominique and Jordan and Vince Carter.
And this is Warford. Taking on the far side. Nice spin move for first down yardage out close to the 40-yard line. There's a little bit of that electricity we talked about earlier in Marquise Warford.
And this is what you have. In order to be a great runner, you have to have great balance and vision. And watch the balance off this play. One step cut, gets there, whoop, spin move inside. What's that, the X button they call it on?
It's the X button.
He's a joystick type player. He's effective running on the edge. I think they have to be careful how often they're running between the tackles.
Cookman, almost a lateral as he was in the clutches here. He gets it to the near side of Javorian McKenzie and turns what could have been quite a negative play into positive yards before Richardson and Elliott Miller combined on the tackle, and it was a pickup of 7.
It was a 7-yard pickup. It was Wildcat defense is flying all over the field. They almost had a sack on Footman in the backfield. He gets the ball away, and there are 2 Wildcat defenders there to make the tackle. You have to do some counter moves to get the aggression to slow them down.
Warford trying to dance through a hole inside. Ooh. Didn't pick up much. A lot of the big guys in the middle there bring him down.
It's getting physical down there. I mean, it's been clear. When Warford gets the ball, they're going to let him feel it a little bit. So, normal run between the tackles, a little extra takedown. He's a marked man. They know that.
We talked to him yesterday, and he was quite enthusiastic about returning to the backfield. He said, I've been playing there since Pee Wee football.
That's my natural position. You're going to see me do something tomorrow.
Yeah, but this ain't Pee Wee football. And running in between the tackles is, I mean, that's a man's man. And he's tough enough to do it, but physically, I just don't know if that's where he belongs. He can do it, but I'd like to see him attack the edge a little bit more.
Third down and four, and the swing pass is complete. And they'll be close to first down yardage as he hits DeLance Turner before Jason Smith, one of those who brought him down, but not in time enough to prevent the first down, so they'll move the sticks.
Right now, you see Alcorn going a little up-tempo, trying to wear down the home team here.
And a quick hitter. Bouncing outside is Turner. And Turner goes down, pushed out of bounds at about the 32-yard line, picked up 18 on that one.
And they're attacking the perimeter. They're having success running on the outside. Good balance and vision by Turner. Making the most of it. I really think there's a good job of going to the hurry-up offense, trying to kind of reverse the tide on the poor Cookman and force their defense to get tired.
That team's looking much sharper on their fourth possession. Now we have a partner to really step up.
He's got the size. He's played at a high level. And so far, I'd say he's doing a pretty good job because they've had success running the football to the right side of the line.
On first and 15. Warford trying to bounce it outside, and he is caught and held on to for dear life. And one of those who did it was Kevin Johnson. And it'll be a loss of yards on play. Actually, no gain on the play.
Just look at the red jerseys. Two waiting for him to hold there. Then he wants to bounce it. The other guy's holding on. Two more to go. I think you have to decoy Warford right now. Yeah. Play action. Give him a fake like he's going to run the football and try and go over the top. Because it's clear that Bethune Cookman is honed in on number 10, wherever he is on the field, and they're sending one or two bodies after.
And only 185 pounds, a 300 pounder is probably not going to let you go if you're scared.
There it is.
Wide open. Wide open. McKenzie. Touchdown.
Perfect play call. Perfect play call. You knew all eyes were going to be on Warford when he left the backfield. They were looking and kind of peeking in the backfield, go over the top. This is a great job. It all starts with the motion by Warford, leaving the backfield. Quick pump fake like you're going to throw the ball right to Warford. Go over the top. Good job of getting behind the coverage by McKenzie. And he just done it. That throws him for a loop, allowing the wide receiver to slip by untouched almost for the touchdown grab. It's good recognition by the defense of knowing where Warford is, but I think they paid him too much attention and allowed McKenzie to slip behind.
I stand corrected. Warford not quite bald. That's kind of my haircut. I think I might have influenced him when I met
him. But we're just a kid. Yeah. We're going to call you looking not quite bald. You said it, not
me. Not quite bald. For me, though, it's to cover up some bald, so I'm sure it's not the same. First down at their own 6-yard line. Brim will keep. Gets to the corner. Grim fumbled the football. It is recovered by Alcorn State. And Grim can't believe it. Eric Foster was the one who recovered it. He knocked it away, actually.
Grim, you know, he can run the football, does a good job holding on to the ball, getting outside. But Foster, the big time talent, able to draw the ball loose. And that's DeAndre Smith that makes the recovery. We said that guy, Eric Foster, he's just that guy. He's that guy that's going to make plays for this defense. NFL prospect has the ability to play nickelback, safety, or cornerback. And costly turnover for Bethune Cookman. Let's see if Alcorn can make him pay.
And Graham seems to be wincing just a little bit as he comes over to the side of the field position inside the 20.
Look at Walford, lined up in the slot. Now he's in motion.
Going to the end zone, got his man wide open, and that is DeLance Turner for an easy touchdown, and suddenly Alcorn strikes twice, and they lead it 13-7. 18 yards on that.
They figured out something. They're going to quickly get to adjust. Drew Walford in motion come across. You know they're going to keep track of where he is. That safety, hold him high. One-on-one, running back versus linebacker. Offense wins that 9 out of 10 times. No help over the top. Schematically, great play selection by Alcorn State.
Jason Smith was in coverage on that play and he beat badly for the touchdown. For the extra point, Corey McCullough will attempt to put the Braves up by 7, 8:25 to go here.